If the docetic views of Jesus lay at one extreme, then there was another equally controversial group whose views lay at the other. Whilst the docetists claimed Jesus only appeared to be mortal, this sect believed he was most definitely a human, but one hijacked by God. Here in Israel, traces of another lost gospel can be found. It's a text which shockingly suggests that Jesus, although singled out by God, was born a mere mortal. It was the work of a sect now virtually forgotten, known as the Ebionites. They were Christians, but they were strongly committed to maintaining the Jewishness of their faith. They believed Jesus was the Jewish Messiah sent by God to fulfill Jewish scripture. Although this sect were by no means the only Jewish Christians at the time, after all, Jesus had been a Jew, as had all his earliest followers, the Ebionites provoked some of the most vociferous opposition. Their name comes from the Hebrew word Ebion, meaning poor. It was a term their opponents used to their advantage, accusing them not of being poor in material wealth, but in understanding. Unlike other Christian groups such as the Gnostics and the Docetics, although the Ebionites must have written their own gospels and treatises, none of them have actually survived. In fact, the only reason we know about them at all is because their heresies have been immortalized in the works of their opponents. Glimpses of the gospel have surfaced in the writings of an early Christian named Epiphanius. One of his most lengthy texts is known as the Panarion, and in it he attacks no fewer than 80 heretical groups and their books. Professor Larry Hurtado has studied it.
What does Epiphanius say in the Panarion about the Ebionites?
He doesn't like them. He lists them as one of a whole menagerie of various Christian groups that he regards as heretics. It's a kind of handbook of every kind of Christian belief you never want to embrace, among which he lists the Ebionites as one of them. Basic things that he says is that he describes them as a kind of Jewish Christian group, and he says that they prefer their own gospel over against the four gospels that are recognized by other Christians.
And what was this gospel?
One writer describes it as being a version of the Gospel of Matthew in Hebraic language with certain things missing, but it raises about as many questions as it does settle.
But if the Gospel of the Ebionites was based on a work that was accepted into the New Testament, why on earth was it considered heretical? Well, if we study the accusations of their opponents, there's one shocking difference between the two texts. In Matthew's Gospel, Jesus is said to have been miraculously born of a virgin. But the Ebionites disagreed. So in their gospel, they left out the story of the Nativity. They believed that rather than being conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of a virgin, Jesus was born the eldest son as a result of the sexual union between his parents, Mary and Joseph. But for Epiphanius and for others like him, such beliefs were heretical, and any gospel containing such ideas had to be stopped. The problem with the rejection of the virgin birth was that it cast doubts on Jesus' divinity. If there was no miraculous conception, then what made Jesus different
from any other man. Well, the Ebionites believed it was his baptism that transformed him. For them, it was this moment when he became the Son of God.
The Ebionites are accused of not believing in the virgin birth, of rejecting the idea of Jesus being born special. They supposedly distinguish between the man Jesus, who was just an ordinary man born and died in an ordinary way, and the divine Christ. So Jesus Christ for them is not one, but two entities. And the man Jesus is used as a vehicle of the divine Christ, who comes upon him at a certain point, at his baptism, and then uses him as the human vehicle for the ministry. So at his death, the divine Christ deserts him, leaves him, goes up to heaven, and the man Jesus is left to die. So if that's the case, then they would have thought of not technically of Jesus as being divine, but of Jesus as being inhabited by divinity in some sense.
What was the problem with that for the Orthodox leaders of the church?
One of the problems that causes for Orthodox Christians is that how you understand Jesus is closely connected with how you understand salvation and how you understand how salvation was worked out. The emergent Orthodox view is that in order for Jesus to win salvation for humans, he had to be A, authentically human, but he also had to be genuinely divine, both. And that had to include a real bodily death. Well, in this Ebionite view, as it is ascribed to them, the divine Christ simply, you know, kind of parachutes down at a certain point and then opts out at a certain point. And the notion is you have a real separation, therefore, between the divine and the human, which prevents the two from having a real power and efficacy for salvation.
Complicated stuff. But the Ebionites were grappling with an extraordinary idea: God made man. And perhaps it's precisely the complexity of the concept that explains why Gospels like those of the Ebionites and the Docetists were still circulating during the 3rd and 4th centuries. What they were discussing, after all, was not a simple question: the nature of Christ. And the philosophical contradictions that that provoked were not ones that were going to be easily resolved. But the Gospel of the Ebionites did achieve something. Along with the Docetic texts, the Gospel was one of the works which helped the early church to begin to define what was and what was not acceptable in the debate about Jesus' true nature. Without such works to react to, it might well have taken the church longer to clarify exactly what it meant when it claimed that Christ was both human and divine. The church's final doctrine stated that Jesus was God from God, but also truly human. It was a statement which immediately condemned the Gospel of Peter and the Gospel of the Ebionites to the dustbin of heresy.